No, not breast cancer. Other diseases, yes. But when I started it, I read a book called The Secret. I don't know if you've ever...
Thank you. she is with you. So be with us now as we come before you and as we remember her, as we celebrate her life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. At this time, I'd like to welcome up Karyn's brother, Jeff Sork. Karyn Elizabeth. Born October 25th, 1977, to Verna and William Sorek, Karyn had a lifelong passion for running and fitness. But it wasn't until she graduated from the University of the Pacific in Stockton, California, and married the love of her life, Jim, that Karyn discovered her most dear passion, and that was raising a family. After the arrival of their first son, care and researching rigorous curricula that both challenged her kids and opened their minds to each kid involved in a dizzying array of activities at their church and in the community. And then as the family moved from Sacramento to Oklahoma City, back to California, Karyn was diagnosed with medullary thyroid cancer in April 2011, and she fought the disease with the same vigor and wonder that she approached all her projects. Calling on her many talents, she battled with her fitness, her intellect, her spirituality, and of course, in her five adoring children, Ben, 14, Zach, 12, Eva, 10, Sam, 9, and Olivia, 7. She's also survived by her parents, Vernon and Bill, and me, her brother, Jeff. So Karyn and I weren't always close. In fact, earlier this year, when we were attending a services, we were chatting about my friend Ryan and about his dad, Ted. And she reminded me that during our senior year, Karyn was a freshman, we were seniors, that Ryan drove her to school each day. And, you know, kind of appropriate for a senior, Ryan did make the occasional detour to a local breakfast place called Chuck's, where he could get a cup of coffee and a couple of their...
Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. I thought this was the perfect verse for her, knowing what she was going through, to make sure she was comfort, not afraid. And while I'm up here, I'd like to say some words about her. This family has been through a lot. We've traveled from Sacramento to Oklahoma and back to Fresno. And when we came back to Fresno, my dad found the perfect job that he loved. But something was wrong. She didn't like the house. It was a two-story, small, in a neighborhood that was not great, barely had any kids. So while we were there for 3 years, she kept fighting and trying to find the perfect house for us. And she did. She found the one in a cul-de-sac, a one-story, and with the pool. Before she got weaker, she always ran with Max, and when she came home, she'd always read the devotional. And when we moved into that house, and we were comfortable and happy, God came down and said, Karyn, my sweet loving child, you have done so much, and it's time for your family now to do it, and I'm gonna save you. And that's what happened. He came down and saved her.
in with that, I'm also battling a rare thyroid cancer. I was diagnosed with stage 3 medullary thyroid cancer.
And at that moment, our world stopped.
It cannot be treated with radioactive iodine. It does not respond to radiation, and it does not respond to chemotherapy.
A more rare...
Can you done for Karyn? Karyn pursued me as a sister for a lot of my life. And one of the story I'm going to tell is about a time that I went to visit her because she just... Ben was 2, and Zach was 6 months old. And Ben was a rascally toddler, and Zach had poofy black hair.
And that's how we stayed connected with the progression of the cancer with Karyn. But it also gave us a light into the congregation here, because I would continually see these, and it was a real source of comfort living up there, knowing that the Jakob family had this beautiful support that was walking alongside of them. So thank you for that.
Well, I thought that was going to be easier than having to speak after all that. How are you all doing? Thanks for being here, guys. If you don't know me, I'm Jim. I keep getting referenced on the speeches before me. I want to first off find my notes on my phone, like Jenny did. I'll start by saying, while I'm getting to this, I thank you guys from the bottom of my heart for being here. Those that are in attendance here today, those that will watch this online on the video someday, for my kids who will be able to watch this for the rest of their days, thank you for being here. You all have given me a lot of strength, more so than you know. The texts, the phone calls, the emails, the whatever. I wrote down food, donations, rides for my kids that I don't have to worry about, dropping off toys my kids are not playing with, ears to listen. You all have been there for me for that, and I really thank you for that. And I will continue to thank you for that. It's just been wonderful. I love all you guys. You know, I got people in here from my best friend Ed Nieto from Portland, Oregon, to my work folks, my ABC 30 family, to I haven't been able to see everybody here, so sorry if I missed you, but people that have been walking in our lives for however many years we've been walking in our lives. And it's because of Karyn that I think the power of Karyn that y'all are here, and power that's given me the strength to even speak right now to get through this. It has not fully processed for me yet, guys, so just know that this will be a very long process. Peggy, I appreciate your advice on that. I have no idea what it's going to be like, so all I know is that I've got to be strong, and strong for my kids, strong for me, strong for Karyn's legacy, y'all. She had one heck of a legacy. She set the bar doggone high. I mean, doggone it, Karyn. Why'd you make it so hard? It's your family. So what they said before I got up here. So anyway, we're going to kind of lighten the mood just a little bit, and then I'll kind of bring it back down a little bit. But you know, some of the videos that y'all saw there, I'll reference those briefly. The fight song video. Boy, what an emotional video that was for me to put together. I'll tell you, I put that together. We were in Mexico. Y'all had this community, I mean, everybody in here, this community worldwide, I mean, friends in New Zealand and everybody donated to that cause. We got Karyn there. She wanted to go to that clinic like nothing else. And I wasn't going to let $25,000 stand in the way. You all weren't going to let that happen. And doggone, we didn't let that happen. We got her there. And the alternative treatments she got there was everything she wanted. Nothing she ever wanted to do was stopped by a financial reason because of people in this room, people that will be watching this later. And from the bottom of my heart, I thank you guys for doing that for her, because that trip to Mexico meant a lot to me, meant a lot to her, especially now knowing we gave this thing everything we absolutely could here on this earth to fix that disease inside of her body. So I will always be thankful for that. I don't know if Max DeVivo is in here, but I'm going to give you a shout out. If you're here, raise your hand, Max, if you're here. Say he's going to be here. Max Vivo is with a band called Foreign Unauthorized here. It's a tributary band here in Fresno. And one day he watched Karyn's story on ABC 30 Action News and reached out to his friend Kevin Musso, one of our meteorologists. And Kevin said, hey, we got to give this guy a call. I said, wow, okay, we'll give him a call. He set up a benefit concert for Karyn last year that it was amazing. And I told him the other day when I talked to him on the phone that I will never, ever forget that, that he was so kind to us to do that and to see all the community come out for that. Some of you that are in the audience, I can see Winston, I see you, I know you were there. A few of my friends were there. A lot of people went to that concert. And in the video you'll see towards the end of the service, a lot of the great photos towards the end of it, a lot of the photos that we got of Karyn were in from that concert. Those of you know Karyn know that she absolutely hates taking a picture. I mean, Shauna Hill told me that she looked through thousands of pictures. Shauna Hill is one of Karyn's best friends. She's right down here. Looked through thousands of pictures. She didn't have one stinking photo of her and Karyn together. Karyn hated taking pictures. She didn't want to stop down to do that. She would rather do life with you rather than do selfies with you. And that's who she was. She was just a light in this world, a light for me. So, anyway, I'm kind of holding on to this here. I'll show this to you guys. It's on video forever. But this was a cross that one of our friends gave us. I think they may be in attendance, or you can tell me afterwards because I don't want to say the wrong name if it wasn't you. But they gave her this cross a while back. And I remember this cross specifically because she would take this to many of her doctor appointments for the last year or so. And she would just kind of hold on to it, you know, kind of rub it as she was getting whatever news the doctors were telling her. It's usually bad news. But she found great comfort in this. So I've got that right here with me. I'm actually going to put that in my pocket while I keep on going here, so I can keep on going. Grab a swig of water. I'll keep on going here. I'm going to take you back to 1998. Don't worry, I'm not going to go year by year. Got to get some food going here at some point. So 1998, I told people this yesterday, so you guys are going to hear this again. 1998, I was at KCRI Television in Sacramento, and I had everything figured out, guys. I was 22 years old. I was riding high. I had a small house. I had a car. I had a paycheck. I had benefits. I mean, it was great. I was living the life. And little did I realize that my life was going to change as soon as a beautiful, probably 20, 21-year-old intern walked in the door and sat down across from me. And I said, oh my goodness. Boy, do I know nothing about anything right now, because that girl's got it all figured out. And came to know her a little bit. That 1998, if you'll remember, there was a little issue in the White House with an intern. So I didn't feel like I could really approach her for obvious reasons. I didn't want to be that guy over again. So fortunately, for whatever reason, and this is a God thing, because there was no reason for her to want to hang out with a kind of a loser dude like me at that time, she asked me if I could go and meet her for coffee. And I said, whoa. I took that opportunity and I said, actually, you know what? I'd love to do that, but why don't we go do dinner and a movie instead? Kind of upped the ante on her a lot, apparently. Her parents probably remember that one. So I'm going to give you three reasons why this is an absolute God thing. It all comes from our first date. Here's the top three things probably to never do on a first date. Number one. Set up a clandestine meeting place that neither of you really know much about before cell phones were invented, and then try and find each other. Didn't work out so well. She was at one corner, I was at another corner, we both thought we got stood up. Until the very, about 10 minutes later, we both saw each other, fortunately, from a distance. So, God thing number one. Number two, went to Chevy's. No, went to a restaurant. I can't remember which one it was. It was Chevy's. Anyway, I ordered salmon. First date. Salmon. No breath, man. And then I took her to the movie. If anybody's seen the movie, it's pretty rough comedy. Something About Mary. Wow. How she even stayed in the theater with me, I don't know. Anyway, fast forward to the end of the date, we go to the car, say goodbye, there was no kiss. Called my brother Bob, I'm like, yeah, that one went down in flames. There was no kiss. His first question to me, well, what the heck did you have for dinner? I said, well, it's salmon. There you go. Kiss a salmon mouth either. So I thought it was dead. The relationship could have just fizzled right then and there, but I thought it was over with. I thought, yeah, no, next time maybe. That girl, boy, I tell you, my friend Maddie Yuseblad, I don't know if she's here or not, but she was an assignment editor at KCRA, and I told her, you know, I think it went bad, it's horrible. She was kind of the person that really set us back up for a second day. She said, no, you need to ask her out again. I'm like, oh, come on, that's Sam. Stuck me. First impression. Fortunately, she said yes, and we went out again, and went out many, many, many more times after that, and it was great. It was really, really great. So, you know, it was a God thing that we even had this relationship. She made sure that I opened my eyes to a much larger world than the one I was living in. I was living in a bubble, house to work, back to house to work, back to house to Mountain Mike's Pizza occasionally because I was eating like junk. And she made me better, guys. I mean, I wasn't supposed to be this good. I wasn't. She made me better. Bob said it yesterday. She grew me up, and she absolutely did. She grew me up, and I'm a better man for her because of her. I didn't even realize that good people lived in Stockton. I went down there, and that's where she lived. I couldn't believe people actually lived there, but it was actually a pretty nice place to be. So I opened my eyes and said, okay, maybe it's not all about my little house in the ghetto in Sacramento and KCRA TV. Let's see what else we got out there in the world. And we lived a lot of life together. We went to Maui and had our honeymoon there. She was just my light, and she was such a light in this world that to see that light extinguished as quickly as it happened here was very, very disheartening to me. I wish that I could have done more. I feel like we did everything we absolutely could in this world. I think Karyn did too. There was some things said by family members here recently that I totally forgotten about. Absolutely forgotten about this. But Karyn, when we first got married, first met actually, she never wanted to talk about death. It was the one topic that was off limits for her. She could not bring herself to talk about death. And I always thought it was kind of strange. Of course, I was 22. I had it all figured out. But she didn't want to talk about it. And it was because she had such a fear of it. She was so fearful of death for some reason. I don't know why. I never met anybody quite like that. But over the years, as we went to church, we grew in our faith, and we had our kids, and she just learned to love the Lord. And at some point, I don't even remember when it was, she stopped worrying about it and just never talked about it, but did not worry about it. And I thought, and I was going to get to the point here where we talk about the last couple of months, she had no fear. No fear at all about what was happening. And that's remarkable. My sister Tammy said that one of the last conversations that she had with her last week or week before that, Karyn was, you know, really in bad shape. And even still, Karyn said, We all have our own time. Why, it's just coming sooner. No fear. Fear was gone. So, amazing. This picture here, I'll just point it out because I absolutely love this picture of her. I was going through our wedding album. I hadn't seen this in 16 years. Saw it the other day and just absolutely loved that photo. It captured Karyn in a moment of complete and utter joy. That was our wedding reception. At the Holiday Inn up in Stockton. Here, apparently people are happy in Stockton occasionally. So Karyn hung with me for a lot of stuff, guys, a lot of tough stuff. I had some tough times in Oklahoma City. Boy, she got me through a lot of tough stuff in Oklahoma City. We moved back there. And the move back here, nothing about it made any sense. Nothing about it made any sense that I was, you know, coming back to a smaller media market. I was coming back to a job that was a little bit less than a job than what I had in Oklahoma City. I was working nights, took a pretty sizable pay cut to come back here, so we left a low-cost living area to come to a high-cost living area. Nothing about that move made sense. We had a two-story house, no pool, a busy street. She hung with me, guys. She hung with me on all of that stuff, and boy, I can't even tell you how much of that means to me as a husband. What I put her through. So for her to be able to make it through all that and still, like Jeff said, she set up a community of people that loved on her. She loved right back. Our kids are so plugged in as a result of all that. I mean, this isn't a community that she didn't really want to be in, but she learned to love it and found the right house. Like, Zach, I'm so proud of Zach for getting up here and talking. I had no idea what he was going to say or where he was going with that. I was like, hopefully there's not a big class coming at me. But he did a good job. She found the house that she wanted. And I think she always knew her body better than any doctor ever did, because she held in there from January through June when she finally found that house. And I kid you not, it was literally a couple of days after we moved into that house that her body just said, okay, we've done our job. Got them to a safe place. And let's be there. So I can't even tell you how much I appreciate her and all of you guys. I want to kind of wrap this up a little bit with a message to each one of my children, since I feel like we are going to be empowered and in charge of Karyn's legacy, not just me, not just them, but the whole community. We dedicated each one of our children in church, and if you've ever been to a child dedication before, you know that when you're up there, you hold the baby up, pastor holds the baby up, and say, okay, now everybody in the congregation, will you agree to help nurture and raise these children alongside these people? And we all down said yes. Well, that rings real true now. I mean, I'm going to need a lot of help, guys. There's no doubt about it. I'm man enough to admit that. I can't do everything. I appreciate everything everybody does right now, and it's going to do in the future for us. I know you're all going to be there. And I love this community so much. I really do. I love my Zach. Dad loves his job. Yes, he does, Mike. I didn't put him up to that. Yeah, there you are. I didn't put Zach up to that. I do. I absolutely love my job at ABC 3. It is the people at my workplace just give me so much strength and so much ability to just kind of do my life. It's just amazing. I have a saying that I've kind of developed over the years. It was invest in others that cannot invest in me. And so with my team there at ABC 30, I would hold meetings, weekly meetings, and for no other reason to bring them up, make them better, to tell them about my career, my experiences, and the good, the bad, the ugly, so they can maybe avoid some of the pitfalls that I ran into. And all of that was because I wanted to invest in others that could not invest in me. Little did I know that saying was so untrue. They have invested back in me more than they even know. And I will continue to do the same for all you guys over there. I see it. I can see it. So my message is to the kids. All right, here we go. I want to start with Ben. Ben is our oldest, and Karyn really thought he could act. And he's a great little actor. He knows his lines. He can memorize his lines like nobody else's business. And she recognized that early and really was pushing him to do that. So, Ben, I don't know if you're going to be an actor someday, but you can do whatever you want. But Mom really believed in you early, and so do I. Zach. Boy, little Zach. Zach Attack. Zach with the black hair. Zach was he's a brave, brave young man. He got up here today. He wanted to. Got up there yesterday at our private graveside service. I didn't know he was going to do it. He did it. Zach's a brave young man. One of the last things I remember Karyn saying, and the last dinner she had at our dinner table, she was sitting right next to Zach. And he had given her a hug and said, I love you, Mom. She looked over at him and looked back at me and said, that's a good boy. So, Zach, you get to keep being a good boy. Kid wants to build roller coasters. He wants to do engineering. So I told him, man, I'm not a big roller coaster fan, but you build a roller coaster, I'll ride it. So it's on tape now. All right, Eva Jakobs, a 10-year-old Eva. She is smart as a whip, and I'm so proud of her. Karyn was so proud of her for everything she does in ballet. She's great at ballet. She's been doing dance for 8 years, and she's such a great ballet person, just great. I don't even know what to say about that. I know nothing about ballet, other than it's really pretty. But Eva does fantastic at that. And Eva, at school, so the three younger ones had to go into public school. Eva had been homeschooled with Mom since first grade. She's in fifth grade now. Her first progress report literally had been there 3 weeks, was probably behind everybody because they started late, behind everybody. Got a progress report back, 104%, 102%, 100%. I mean, just smart as a whip. So Eva, you just keep on being smart, and we'll be right there with you. All right, Sam, my big old little Sam over here to the right, Karyn absolutely loved watching him play soccer. This kid just loves soccer, and he is such a great soccer player. Karyn got to see him one last time about 2 months ago, and Sam did really well. I was so proud of him the other day. His whole team wore these orange armbands. You see my kids wearing. Karyn's favorite color was orange. His whole team wore orange armbands at their game last Saturday that were made by the coach's wife as a fashion designer. She made them the day before. She was going to make them black, but then Olivia said, well, mom's favorite color was orange, so I had to get back to them. Hey, can you make them an orange? They made them an orange. So he scored a goal for his mom from the fullback position in that game. So Sam, just keep on being a great little stud and athlete and smart as you are, buddy. All right, be right there with you too. Olivia. Oh, Olivia. Oh, boy. I think Jeff mentioned something about Karyn being stubborn. All right, Olivia, you get to be stubborn. You get to have that from your mom. I'm telling you, I've told her teacher this too. There's going to be no man in her life that tells her what to do. There's no doubt about that. Barely listens to me, and that's under threat of physical injury usually. So, Libby, you are very smart. She's also in ballet with Eva. They just do so good, so really good. So I really appreciate you guys all being here. I'm really trying to wrap this up. I'll admit I didn't do a speech because I couldn't put it on paper what Karyn meant to me, what she meant to all of you. Her legacy will live on. I guarantee you that, if not through me, but through all my kids, through our family. She will resonate because of family. Family first. We will have a big family. Our families will get together for whatever, cousins, and we treat our cousins more like brothers and sisters, and that's a result of Karyn. She was just such a family-oriented person, and you know, you look back at me at that 22-year-old kid back there thinking he knew everything. No way. I didn't have a clue, guys. I had no clue until she came into my life and taught me everything that she was about. And, finally, my message to Bill and Verna. Bill, where'd you go? I know you're over here. There you are. You're right back. My message to Bill and Verna is I am just, I don't know what to say. I'm so sorry, you guys. I wish that I could have saved her. Did everything we could. And I'm just glad that I get to be in your lives forever. You know, there's no doubt about that. Your grandkids are going to be whatever you want, they're yours. So. That's not a bad thing. So I will keep visiting you both in Stockton until I can entice you to move down here for us. And then my family, I appreciate you guys so much for everything you've done in the last couple of weeks. And one final thought, I'll just share with you kind of the last moment with Karyn. The night that she passed, I knew that it was coming. I could tell. Her breathing it changed somewhere in the middle of the night, and I'd been setting my alarm clock all night long to give her that medicine right on the dot every time she needed it without her having to ask, because she got to the point where she couldn't. And I just told her over and over, baby, you got nothing to worry about. I got you. I got you. And that did. Her biggest fear was that she was going to die alone in a bed someplace. So I cranked her hospital bed all the way up to a parallel with my bed, took her side room, joined those beds, and when she started changing her breathing,